We're on to item number three, which is postpone. Which is an appeal of a decision of the zoning board of appeals.
Give a brief introduction. AV120001, Carol M. Albert, located in Commission District Number 2. This is a public hearing by Carol M. Albert regarding the acceptance of a consent order for Rocklyn Homes, Inc., AP120001 by the Appeals Board on September 4th, 2012. The property is located on the west side of James Burgess Road, approximately 1,730 feet south of the intersection of Keystone Drive, and is currently zoned Res 3.
Mr. Chairman, if the board would allow, may I respectfully walk the board through the procedures this evening? We have, or at least had, three appeals all related to the same action. We have two now. But in anticipation of this appeal, the parties, quite frankly, have worked together. And we had circulated to the various parties some agreed upon procedures. And all of the parties have agreed to those procedures. And so if the chairman will give me some discretion, I would at least like to walk the board through those procedures, walk the gallery through those procedures, tell everyone what they might be able to anticipate, so we're all sort of off the same playbook. And then I will turn it over to you, Mr. Chairman, to open up the administrative hearing and allow the hearing to proceed. The parties are Ms. Carol Albert. Is Ms. Albert here? I'm sorry, I don't. Would you mind if you could just come down to the front and maybe take a seat down there, because you're going to need to approach. And then, of course, we have Keystone HOA. Is there anybody from Keystone HOA here? If you're going to present, and we had agreed in the procedures that board members could present, so if you could please as well come down. Is there anyone from Rocklyn Homes? I hear. All right. It must be Ms. Everett. Okay, if you would come down as well. So I think we sort of have our parties, if you will, and of course, I'll be speaking on behalf of the planning department. But let me walk you through the procedures. This has been basically broken down into two elements for each of the appeals. One is the issue of standing, and the other one was the issue of if standing, the board will need to make a decision on standing. The other one was on the merits, okay? So here's how we broke it down. The Board of Commissioners will, as soon as I finish, and everyone may be favored with questions, they can ask questions, but as soon as we've gotten through the preliminary stages of this, the Board of Commissioners will open the public hearing, and then the petitioner, which will be Ms. Albert for the first petition, will be able to address the issue of standing. To the clerk, I will say there is a, let me, Sonny, if I could give you this as well, because there are some time limitations in there. The first presentation will have up to 10 minutes on the issue of standing, then followed by the applicant, which will be Rocklyn, will then have up to 15 minutes to respond. Now again, these are seedlings. They don't have to be 15 minutes, but they could be. The party of record, which would then be the county, I will have 10 minutes to address you on the issue of standing. And then in the interest of fair play, Ms. Albert would have 5 minutes to respond or rebut. And then of course, the board will be entitled to ask questions. Then we will close the administrative hearing on this portion of it. And then you'll need to make a decision on the issue of standing. If you make the decision that there is standing and the case can proceed, then we go into the merits. Of course, in which case, all of this starts over again and we get to hear Ms. Albert's first, et cetera, on the merits, if you will. And that'll be the case for both of these petitions. All right, so that's the procedure. I would ask, and to those of you who are sort of parties to this case, the rules that we all agreed to allow both appeals to be consolidated, if you chose to. Does anybody want to do that, or do you want to keep them separate for purposes of going forward? There's really no, if we combine them, then all of the times get doubled, because we're not going to take away anybody's time. But this is totally up to you. I don't prefer to go and do it that way. I would prefer to go ahead and keep them separate. And if you want to do that, that's fine. That's the way it's in the agenda book. So I'm not hearing a groundswell of interest in consolidating. So, Mr. Chairman, if you're agreeable, I think we'll keep them separate. We'll do it that way. So I think, does any of the parties, if you will, have any questions on the process? Please.
My name is Cameron Albert. In the first 10 minutes, does that include my witness, Tim Harbin, or does he get a little couple of minutes?
The question she's asking is she is actually going to introduce live testimony, and so bring somebody down and sort of walk them through some testimony. Ms. Albert, yes, that would include, that would be consumed within your time, your 10 minutes. Understand, members of the board, you have the right, if an individual on this hour says, look, I could use some more time, and you want to give some more time, you have the right to do that, and that the extra time will go to everyone else as well. So if you give this hour 5 minutes, everyone else just got 5 minutes. Okay? All right, having said all that, Mr. Chairman, I think it would be appropriate for the board to open up the administrative hearing and ask you to present her case on stand.
There's only one point of clarification. Is this a public hearing or administrative?
It is an administrative hearing subject to these procedural rules. So this is not anybody who just wants to come speak can come speak. This is fairly narrow and constrained as far as you can
see. Your motion to open the administrative hearing.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. There's no further discussion to the vote. And that is unanimous. Shall we start with Ms. Lady? Could you tell us again who you want?
Yes, my name is Carol Albert, and I represent Champion Blinds Homeowners. And thank you very much for allowing me to speak again. I was here about a month ago, very gracious for you to allow us another opportunity to present our objections to the spring buffer variance decision. My Exhibit A, I've attached names, addresses, checks with the intention at the very beginning to split. We have a meeting of 10 homeowners to split the cost of the appeal to be a group because we could not appeal through the HOA. So this would include our collective standing. A little overkill, I put all of my documents in. Hopefully you have a chance to look at those. The first criteria is, to my understanding, to get standing this, is the decision by the ZBA is detrimental to the general health, welfare, and safety of the public. It is my belief that, as was referenced earlier, that being in a FEMA flood zone, first of all, the stream buffer variance to reduce the stream buffer from the current county codes, which have been adopted and established, and other builders have had to abide by those codes. This is something that the county felt was important to establish these for a standard, and I believe that's to Forsyth County's benefit. It's my second commissioner's meeting now. And I've got a lot of rhetoric about stream buffers and the health benefit of those stream buffers, and hopefully, I'm trying to get through my 10 minutes here. One thing that's very important to me on Exhibit B, if you can look through my pamphlet. If you look at the maps, you can see, first of all, where I'm sitting on the property. But the most important map to me is a Google map. And this one shows where my house is. It shows the new subdivision, which we're not contesting, but we're contesting the variance. It shows the pathway as it leads through Champions Run. It leads down through the Grand Cascades and into the Chattahoochee River. It's considered a main state tributary. This is very, very significant. It's very high on my priority list to have purity of our water supply. As a reference, I'd like to go to the case of Simile versus Pulte, number 09CV0089, in the Forsyth County Superior Court, presided by Judge Bagley. This was October 2011. In this case, it was a similar situation where the land was cleared, for construction, and the neighbors started noticing silt and filling of their pond, and the complete destruction of one acre pond that their home overlooked. And it was a very, very complicated process. We're trying to avoid something like this. We don't want this. I don't want this in my life. In one of the emails I took Ken, I said, I want to resume my normal life. I don't have aspirations of, running with a flag. We want to resolve this so we don't have to do something like this. That we have clean water, we have a safe environment. Our concern is that Rocklyn Homes, which was previously Landmark Homes, has a history of violations. I have reports from the Department of Engineering of consistently 2012, 2011, 2010, 2009. This is Exhibit D. I don't know if I'm showing that, but there's fines, there's second warnings, there's third warnings, there's holds, there's stop orders. They have a very, very long history of abusing and neglecting the environment, of abusing the codes, of abusing the rules and regulations of the county, from the Department of Engineering and other departments, but I'm only speaking to the engineering, to the point that there was a fine, and the EPD imposed a fine of $48,000. And four of engineers had to take them to court to resolve one of these matters of a stream. And that is in Exhibit E. These are the environmental reasons that should give us standing, but to go into the economic impact reasons, there were several homeowners in our group who feel very, very betrayed by Rocklyn Homes. They were promised that they would pay a premium for their lots to have a very large buffer that is not going to exist. They feel disappointment. They feel very, very dismayed by this. To try to move it on. The green space that is also on the property is the pond and the lake. That the green space was put claim to the HOA. There's an Exhibit F and the put claim D, which makes the HOA responsible for what happens with this stream. It makes it responsible for any repairs to the pond or to the Champions Run Lake. And when this was handed over to the HOA, there was already extensive amounts of repair that needed to take place. As you can see in the Schnabel report, is an exhibit of 2006. It's very detailed, and I hope that you will be able to take some time to ponder and to study that. That when this lake and the property was handed over, we were handed a situation already that we're financially responsible for that we have no choice to say about. I would like to call Tim Harbin down to speak about the pond behind his house. And I would like Tim.
My name is Tim Harbin. I live in Champions Run Subdivision. 1600 pounds. Just want to point out, if you look in Carol's booklet, you see the land approximately page 10, you'll just see some pictures of the land in that room. First, I'll say thank you for allowing me to speak, and also thank you to all the county departments and staff that I've met with. They've been very professional and prompt and courteous in all their responses to me. Just to me, that's pictures that tell us, speaking of some words. And that is, I look out and I can see very clearly the pond is filling up with silt, and that's a real concern to me and to those who have a similar view. And it's a concern not just from a viewshed perspective, it's also a concern because we as homeowners, as the residents of Champions Run, would be responsible for the economic cost of putting that out of dredging. And that's a real concern. And I understand that this is a very intricate matter, maybe it's beyond my knowledge base, but I just ask that if you should consider in your deliberations that you'll remember that the problem is bad and it's getting worse. And I have your confidence that you make the right decision for all of this. Thank you.
So, Mr. Commissioners, board members, we hope that you will grant us standing to hear the case that we prepare to alter the decision of the stream level variance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, that's a great point, and actually that will occur after Ms. Albert makes her final rebuttal. There'll be an opportunity for questions from you. Right now, Rocklyn now needs 15 minutes. So.
Site-specific zoning. And so when Rocklyn Homes went to pull a permit for this property,
that's what happened. There was a comment that, no, you need to have 50-foot buffer here. And what we presented to the county is, no, we are allowed to have a 35-foot buffer, as that was what was originally zoned for this site-specific zoning. So that's why we're here. And so in order for these applicants to have standing tonight to even contest the consent order that we entered into with the county to keep this 35 feet, first they have to show that their properties are going to be specifically and specially harmed by having a 35-foot buffer here. And I respectfully present to you that that just hasn't happened. The Georgia Court of Appeals heard a very similar case involving water runoff, and they specifically addressed the standing issue. The case is in Hardin v. Banks County, which was reported at 294 Georgia of Appeals 327. It's a 2008 case from the Georgia Court of Appeals. And in that case, you had an owner who had residential property and sought to rezone to build single-family homes. And there was a stream, and the downstream landowner brought an appeal, appealed the decision. So they had to determine, does this downstream owner have standing to challenge the rezoning of the upstream? And what the court said is, we recognize that muddy runoff is a condition that many neighborhood properties might experience during the subdivision development. But they had to see, was there specific damage to these property owners that were bringing the appeal? And in that case, the property owners bringing the appeal actually owned a landscaping business. And the evidence that they put on an expert testimony, and that expert said, we know that the water's going to get muddy during the construction period. In that case, there was actual proof of that fact, and there was proof that that muddying of the water would happen for about 3 to 5 years during the construction. There was also evidence that that property owner downstream would be unable, they were currently using that water, pulling it out of the stream, and using it to irrigate plants and shrubs that they used in their landscaping business. And they had an expert come and testify that they would no longer be able to do that and use that water for irrigation purposes because of this construction. And so that was very specific, special damage to that business owner. That construction was going to cause them increased cost and therefore decreased profits. And that was the kind of special harm that the court said, you're right, you get standing to appeal. So we're not at the merits here of this case, but what these homeowners have to show is that their individual properties are somehow going to be impacted. And I respectfully represent to you tonight that there is no evidence before you, one, that a 35-foot setback is somehow going to increase sediment in the ponds and lakes. It just isn't there. And in fact, and your staff will tell you, there are a system of BMPs in place for development. Silt fences, double-walled row silt fences, that's what keeps your sediment out of the ponds, not how long how wide your setback is. If we have a hard rain, it can push sediment very far. So that's why you have to have these other systems in place that stop that sediment. So there's no proof before you tonight that having a 35-foot setback as opposed to a 50-foot setback is actually going to increase the sediment in the ponds and lakes. Second, there's no proof before you tonight that the HOA will then somehow have an increased cost as a result of that. Remember, just like increased traffic, it might be a pain, it might just be annoying to the community at large. That's not sufficient. You have to show specific damage to your property. In the evidence that was presented by the applicant last night, there was a comment that one of the homeowners paid more for her lot because she wanted trees and it's pretty big. That might be enough to get standing if we were talking about a setback that came up against her property. In fact, I have a post-it note here. The homeowner identified in those papers is here at lot 182. We're not doing anything different behind her house. There's still gonna be 50 feet here. This is exactly as it was always going to be. What we're talking about is this area down here. Finally, I think Ms. Albert just commented on pure water supply and feeling betrayed and that they just would like to have this large buffer, and I appreciate all of those feelings, but unfortunately, those types of damages, bad feelings, or having a water supply for the whole community is just simply, one, there's no evidence before you that having this 35-foot setback is going to impact the water supply, that just, there's nothing to that effect. But two, that's not the kind of specific harm that you have to show to establish standing. Finally, I may end a few minutes early. Two things. I just would like to remind the board tonight that the Georgia Supreme Court is, when in looking at the standing issue, has specifically said that the evidence before you must be proof. Mere speculation, conjecture, simply is not enough. Unfortunately, that's what we have tonight from the applicants. They don't have any actual evidence or proof that these things they're worried about that could happen will. Finally, I'm not sure if this really fits in our standing, but I will bring it up. I don't believe there's any evidence that the applicants posted a public sign in accordance with your code, section 8-8.4 and 8-3.3. We have not seen any evidence of signs posted at the property, and the applicants are supposed to provide photographs of the signs, and we're not sure that that's happened. So as a procedural point, I will make that note, and we are here to answer questions at the end of the proceedings if you have any.
Thank you again for allowing me to come and clear a few matters up. First of all, she says that Rocklyn and Windmar are not even related. I'm very confused because when I was looking through engineering, I kept seeing the name Tim Jenkins on Windmar. We're going to talk to Mr. Jenkins today about this violation. We're going to talk to Mr. Jenkins tomorrow about that violation. And then in Rocklyn Homes, the documents state Tim Jenkins is being the owner, so that's not as slanderous, but I do believe they are connected. Secondly, I believe that there were two criteria for the standing. One was the environmental impact that is stated in the UDC appeal. The second is the economic. We prepared an economic impact statement that's in the brochure I handed you that itemizes the amount of economic impact that we will face with loss of, now the speculation of lost property value, that is speculation, but with repairs of dredging the pond, we have an estimate of $75,000 to dredge that pond. Champions Run Lake is going to have minimum $100,000 worth of work on that as it stands now. Before construction, we believe this gives us standing. It isn't economic. It's in our pocketbook that we pay for that as homeowners. And we believe that is economic standing. Also, I would like to cite a case. She said there's no proof that stream variance buffers will provide any benefit. There's a case, Knight in Portworth in 1984, that was about the same issue, stream variance. And there was there's another case, Warren Goldman, 1994, that the stream buffers highly affect the water supply. They highly affect what happens down in the Chattahoochee. And okay, do we want that 5 years? Okay, well, we'll give them 5 years. What about your kids that live in Peachtree City? Do you want them drinking that? We hope that you will give us standing, Mr. Commissioners. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, this will be the time for questions.
All y'all know my personality, I have a few, and they're very balanced and equal. I just want to hear from everybody for a couple of items. One, Ms. Albert, did that, I'm looking for personally affectionate, although I am one that also cares about stream and stuff, but I have to follow what the law says. How does this stream quality personally affect you? How do you feel it personally affects you and your values or your emission values?
Sorry, the stream?
You were talking about the water, the quality of the water, and what about children in Peachtree City, but how does it affect you? I have to find that, yes.
I personally don't go back there and drink the water out of that stream, but I have a conviction, just a personal conviction about this matter. And to date myself, when I was a college freshman, I thought I wanted to be a biology major in 1973 at the University of Georgia. I worked study in the laboratory, and the professor would take me out to the greenhouse, and it was microbiology with the study class. He said, "Carol, the future is water. We're our water supply is diminishing. Water is the liquid gold of the future." And that was 1973. I'm not a hippie. I vote Republican. You know, I don't carry flags. And by the way, the sign was blown down by the last storm we had in the hurricane. So it was laying on the ground. So just the light point it out. But no, I don't go drink the water with the input tablets in it. But it affects the quality of the pond, which is on our green space. It affects the quality of Champions Run Lake, which needs repairs, extensive repairs. And then it affects rain cascades, and then it just trickles down. So.
But this has good standards, so I just want to know.
So you were trying to say your special specific home. Also, you mentioned that since you pay the HOA dues and you made a special assessment to fix the pond, that's going to affect you financially. And you said Tim Jenkins' name was part of some people who brought the home that in the past. Is his name also on the memoir claims?
I had engineering reports that we're going to talk to Mr. Jenkins today about this violation.
And you gave us this form showing the violations from both the companies I just mentioned. You put down Windmark Homes, and you, if that's for them in 2012 and Windmark Homes or Rocklyn?
No, 2012, 2011, and 2010 are Rocklyn Homes.
Was this person somebody that's trained in pond remediation?
The pond dredging estimate was by a trained professional, Tam.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah. I saw that thing from the dredging company.
Right. The Champions Run Lake is much, much larger in scope than the pond.
But I'm trying to get to this. Whether was the estimate given to you or your
not
group,
to me personally,
to your group, by someone that's trained in pond remediation, perhaps that might be licensed by the state as an engineer, environmental engineer or something. Is that where it came from?
The Schnabel Report 2006 is a licensed company studying the hydrology of the dam and studying.
That was its Champions Run Lake and Dam Records?
Yes.
Okay.
That's Champions Run Lake.
I'm going back to the largest one, the $200,000, which is pond lake repair, $200,000. Per review and talks with the Smart Growth for Forsyth and environmentalists. For me to be able to consider that, is it somebody that is licensed, somebody that has experience in determining pond remediation? Or is it an estimate by somebody?
Well, I have to say that I did not specifically prepare that $200,000. However, based upon the 2006 Schnabel report and the amount that he at some point in a recess could look at that, the extent of the repairs that need to take place with the dam, the hydrologies of the dam, and also dredging the lake. So I would have to admit that's probably an estimate.
So I don't think we could use that $200,000 in and get that study done. I think that the one that you have verified is one, and then on the real estate damages at 3%, you have a statement from a licensed real estate expert. Who would that be? Do you have a statement you can provide to us?
A statement that I can provide to you?
That says that there's a statement from a licensed real estate expert that the homeowners adjacent to the lakes have suffered. I would like to be able to consider this, but if we don't have something that verifies it from somebody that's an expert, I can't simply take a statement that says some expert told us this. We have to have something that verifies these people are competent in making these kind of recommendations before we can consider them. And I'd like to be able to consider them if you can help me with that.
Well, forgive me that I didn't get that printed out. You can see my manifesto.
You did a great job. No, you did a great job.
There are a lot of holes in it. I did the best I could. Based upon the information that we did have, it's very large, and the scope is very large, and we do really believe that we have a severe economic problem as well as an environmental problem sitting in our backyards.
And you did do a great job on your manifest. I think it's a great job.
One question I had. You talk about the lake dredging. Does the lake need dredging now?
Yes.
Okay. Was this Ben Mark's fault? Or how did the lake, what's your idea? Why is the lake so full of sand?
I've lived on the property for 1 year. I've looked at a lot of documents. I've looked at as many things as I can look at. Apparently, the lake has a history that it has needed repairs for some time. And as documented in the 2006 Schnabel report, which has about four pages, and it was a very detailed licensed company that's very reputable, very detailed report. And the lake and pond has needed repair. And we are very, very concerned. We're not trying to stop the construction. We're very concerned that with a company that has such a history of thumbing their noses at the Department of Engineer, they say they're gonna put the silt black tarp up and they're gonna do all that. Well, they've proven in their history that they don't do that.
Rocklyn or Windmore?
Rocklyn 2012, 2011, 2010.
Rocklin wouldn't even exist.
Right. Yeah. So you're thinking that because it's two separate corporations, we really can't.
Yes, how do we?
Maybe Windmore's, I mean, even that might be the same officer. Well, it's a separate legal entity.
You asked me about the lake. Has the lake needed repair for some time? Yes, I was just answering that.
Yes.
It is documented that it has.
That's what I mean, we're talking about, you say 2006, but
right.
Rocklyn did not exist in 2006.
Right, but I was just saying that the light may have repaired.
If I may add to your kind of your question of do you believe whether or not it existed or could still exist in the future, if you look at 2010, there was 113 first notices from our department and 28 second notices. 2011 was 100 notices and 31 second notices. And 2012 was 85 first notices and 22 second notices. So it seems like the behavior says yes, it could exist. And it could be adding to the problem.
But even if it would exist, Commissioner, we still have to decide a standing issue. Or we're going to be, we've got to decide standing, and then if it is so, if there's no standing, it really is irrelevant. And I guess I would wonder.
The question is there previous damage, and there are more damages occurring, and does it appear that there'll be more damage to come because of bad actors? And you got B&Bs, which is best management possible, and we've heard that from the Rockland representative, but yet there's all of these notices. I mean, there's hundreds of notices to that.
Do you think?
Could I ask a question?
The 2012 only went to October. I had a
Is 85 just till October?
The 2012 only went out to October.
Now, who would you say owns the ponds in your subdivision today?
The owners of the pond is the Homeowners Association. It's quit claimed in my exhibit to the Homeowners Association.
And when it was quit claimed, was it done with the Homeowners Association's knowledge and permission?
I don't know.
Also, why did the homeowners, I think what you said was that the homeowners, you were here because the Homeowners Association was not. Can you tell us why? Was not.
The Homeowners Association is still controlled by Rockland with their bylaws and being able to turn it over to the actual homeowners who live there. And that is why we did come together as a small group and collectively hope that we could get standing collectively together.
And then one other thing. So if this is for me an important point. You're saying that the builder is actually the controlling element of the Homeowners Association right now?
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
And therefore, if this was required to be corrected, not the builder have to pay to do the dredging, that there were representations made, that there was supposed to be a lake there. I'm sure you didn't know how long it would be till it silted up, if ever, but your expectation was there are these lakes here and I expect them to remain.
My expectation, a little background, it may interest you or not, my son, who actually helped me purchase my home, is an environmental scientist, and we looked into that, and the Forsyth County does have existing. They're very high standards, and even when I called Chattahoochee Riverkeeper, they said, well, Forsyth County has some of the highest standards of the state, because I was trying to get some information. And so, to me, it's a travesty to go backwards in time and allow a code that is backwards and say, oh, well, okay, well, you can live with 5 years of silt in your waters and, you know, much more explosion of dirt and filling up the ponds and lakes. You can live with that for 5 years. Well, she doesn't live there.
Thank you.
John, if I could. Director of Engineering, I ask you, when we look at the number of warnings issued to this company, I don't know how many lots are in that subdivision, but how does it stack up to other ones? I mean, I know we're pretty stringent. We issue a lot of warnings in Forsyth County. Is that a higher number or a lower number or an average number, would you say?
I can't say off the top of my head. I mean, it seems like a large number for a large development over a period of time. It may be average.
We're fairly stringent, though. I mean, I know that we issue a lot of warnings.
We are.
And we should be.
We are. You know, anytime there's a violation, the warning notices are issued. But I guess the the true indication will be the number of stop work notices, because if they're not reacting to the warning notices within the required period of time, then we've got to stop work.
Tom, can you explain to me the site-specific zone that was referenced? Or maybe I should ask, and I didn't get your name, I'm sorry.
Stephanie Everett.
Who would be better to address? Would you prefer the name?
I guess start off just by responding to say there was a condition on the original zoning referenced a site-specific approval. Condition number 5 on the original zoning. So the site plan submitted and dated August 14, 2004 shall be the site plan of record for this rezoning. And I imagine that's what was.
And it had 35-foot buffers. And since then, weren't we mandated to make some changes to the setbacks?
Well, yeah, the requirement for 50-foot buffers was a mandate on the county.
That's mandated by the state?
That's correct.
And we're trying to go back to 35?
Well, I think that there may be vested rights.
That was the second part of our preparations.
Thank you. Can I ask Stephanie a question? I want to make sure I get the point correctly. I think I may be verified phrasing this. I think what you sort of said was that if there was damage to everyone, that the law, as you understand it, indicates that you just live with that. But if there is damage to a couple of people and they can show that damage, they have a claim.
We're standing, but it's what we're doing.
So, I mean, I have to say that that's a confounding thing to confront. You know, if everybody gets their property ruined, that's okay. But only if a couple people do, that could be a problem. Why wouldn't you go out of your way to ruin everybody's property?
Weren't you saying that it was a nuisance or something? You're not talking about damage. You were saying that it was a nuisance, or if you didn't like the cloudy water, that that's a nuisance that unfortunately you have to deal with. We're staying in a specific economic.
The law says there has to be special or unique damage in order for a property owner to appeal a decision.
Does that unique qualify the damage or the person who is damaged?
I think that, for example, if you have, well, the first portion of the test, from the first, I emphasize the second prong, but the first prong is a property owner. Have to show a valuable interest in property affected by the challenge decision. So that's the first prompt. So when you talk about the greater community as a whole, that, you know, like just having more traffic in the general area, you have to show a special harm to property that you have an interest in that's directly affected by the challenge, by the decision. If I may, too, just remind everyone that 2 points. One, there's no evidence before you that the setback is going to mean, that 35-foot setback will mean increased sedimentation. It's just not. And the figures on the economic impact exhibit, remember those dredging estimates are based on current conditions. And the test is they have to show something that we're doing in the future is going to cause future harm. And respectfully, I don't, Forsyth does do a great job in issuing violations right away. I've dealt with numerous cases, and that's great. We have a big rain event, and a fence gets knocked down. They're out there reminding us to put it up. And to the point, once Rocklyn Homes has owned this property, there haven't been any stop work orders for this violation. And as far as Mr. Tim Jenkins is concerned, the new entity hired some of the previous employees of Limark Home because they were familiar with this properties, the subject, so it makes sense. So he was an employee of both entities. That doesn't make the two companies related entities. They are separate and distinct entities.
Yes, question. Have y'all built any lots on those 35-foot?
That's going to be my question.
There have been, I believe that's getting to our second point, but I'm happy to answer your questions now. So Well, let me make sure we're real clear. This is, when we talked about the site-specific zoning, this is the site plan that was attached to the zoning, to the ordinance amendment.
Yeah, 35-foot undisturbed buffer.
And it shows 35-foot buffer right here. This is 50. Mm-hmm. This is 35, sorry.
Sorry.
There are 35-foot buffers throughout. And in fact, up here, you see 35. And we, Rocklyn Homes, as Rocklyn Homes, has been issued at least 4 permits to build on lots with 35-foot buffers.
Mr. Chairman, and just as a point of order, forgive me, Ms. I feel like we're drifting a little bit away from standing and drifting into merits. And I do think the court has taken true procedures. We need to stick to standing, so forgive me for that.
Counselor, can I ask a question?
But
when you talk about standing, we're talking about a 50-foot buffer behind their house, but the 35-foot buffer does not touch their property.
That's something for you to take into account.
Okay.
If the board has no further questions, and I don't mean to assume that you don't, but just when you're done, you're willing to close the administrative hearing.
I would like to ask one question, if we could go back to just let her finish the one question, which is, on those houses, she said that they had permits. Have we done any land disturbance inside on any lots with a 35-foot buffer? I think that would talk a little bit towards standing.
I want to make sure the question is clear. Are you talking about within the unit and phase that is at issue here, or are you talking about the subdivision in general, which is where I've been? Because if you're talking about the unit and phase that's at issue here, the answer is going to be no, because the actual plat has been held up for this very reason. So the answer is no.
And we still have to get to how does that show specific standing to this avenue?
That's right. That's like,
yeah, I just did. I'm having great difficulty in even seeing direct, specific standing. Is what I mean. Not that I don't understand the concerns there. I just don't see how it applies to our law.
Are there any other questions? No question from the board?
I do have one more question, Ken. You mentioned a proof that damages may occur. Is that to be considered in the standing?
It is.
On her lot specifically or to the subdivision?
That's going to be up to you. And I am hesitant to dive too far into giving you any specific legal advice. I don't want to overreach because, quite frankly, I'm here on behalf of planning and development. If we get further down the pike, I may stand up and make some arguments.
And can we consider not just their lot, but also they are a member of HOA that owns this park? Whether or not the builders are controlled yet or not, there's still people who pay dues to this HOA and are still owners, partial owners.
Thank you. You can consider that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Rocklyn Homes, we have an option of
taking some time to review all this information and vote at a later date?
The answer is yes to all three of those. You could, you could affirm the appeal, which would mean that you would overturn what was done before the ZBA. You could deny the appeal, which means you would affirm what the ZBA did. You can remand it back to the ZBA with or without direction, or take such other action, including postponing the decision.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a second for discussion. If there's no further discussion, then the motion is to deny. Is that correct? If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that fails 4-1. Let's pledge the floor.
I think we're going to the merit section of the case, or not?
Well, actually, respectfully, I don't believe it needs to be an affirmative decision. I don't stand. I don't believe we
can. Make a motion that there is standing in this case.
Second.
We have a motion.
You realize, Commissioners, if you grant standing so that you can then have a chance to try to mediate the situation, then if it goes to further mediation, create more problems. So this is a little more far-reaching than just a neighbor-to-neighbor kind of disagreement. You realize you put the county in a tough position.
We have a motion. We have a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-1.
And Mr. Chairman, with respect to, we now proceed to the second component of this administrative hearing. This will be on the merits. The time limits will be just as they were for the standing issue. And Mr. Chairman, the board does need to go ahead and open up the administrative hearing. And as before, Ms. Alberts will have the first 10 minutes.
So
second. We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote. And that passes 4-1. We have the administrative hearing open. Ms. Albers.
Thank you for allowing us to proceed with the merits of the case. I understand it's a very complicated legal matter. I am not qualified to evaluate all these because I'm not an attorney, I'm not a legal specialist. I can say that I've done research into the merits of the case. The issue seems to go back to the matter of vested rights. And the zoning, the original zoning was 2004. However, if you look, it's probably hard to find on my pamphlet there. The Rocklyn variance dispute in 2006, there was an application to decrease the buffer from 50 feet to 35 feet, and it was denied. There's been several of those applications that were denied. There have been several that were approved. I will try to stay on track. In terms of vested rights, according to those previous plats being approved, the 35 feet, I believe those were exceptions. Those properties, those lots have been mass graded. They've been sitting there for a very, very long time, empty. I believe that they were approved based on their very individual lots, as they even say, and they show. This does not grant a right to go into a complete mass grading and disturbance. According to the UDC code, section 2 of the UDC code, the section 1811.1 is the applicability. Number 2, it talks about exceptions, and it says, In those two, that because one thing is approved does not automatically approve the other, that it has to go back for a review and back for an approval. And it does state that, and that is in your Forsyth County UDC codes.
In terms of the vested rights, there was a claim of acquired vested rights. I will only speak to what I've done research on. I'm not a legal expert, but my research has turned up that between that 2007, the case that was quoted was the OCGA 44-5-40, the Butts County case. In this case, 2007, they said, to recap it in a musician's language, that there were no vested rights anymore, that they would not be passed on. That's everything that I've read and been passed on. In 2008, Home Builders Associations and people were very concerned about this. They lobbied to Sonny Perdue, and the Georgia State Legislature overturned this decision and came up with another clause that stated that, I think this is what Ken quoted as their basis for allowing vested rights. However, the reason I included an entire section of deeds in the packet is that those deeds were in the period of 2007, 2008, 2009. The vested rights did come back July 1st, 2009. But there was a two-year window that it did not take place. It was not retroactive. It was a window that there was no acquired, there was no passed on vested rights by the law of this passage of the OCGA 44-5-40. If you challenge me with a legal question, I can't answer it. This is something that I would really implore you as commissioners to do some research. If you could get a more legal opinion or a legal expert opinion than mine, this is the research that has been shown to me. So I think that addresses the vested rights, and that's something you might even ask him about. In terms of the legal, I understand this is a very legal, complicated legal matter. We were able to get the letter from Simon Bloom's firm to the Kenneth Gerard, and there were some things that were very, very threatening in the letter, that they were going to, that it was violating their constitutional rights and to seize the property, and some real fighting language in that. And I don't believe anyone's trying to seize Rocklin's property. I think this is a county code that's established, and when a builder comes in and buys a property, let's just throw it out there. She says when Mark and Rocklin Homes are not related. Okay, let's assume they're not related. When Rocklin comes in to buy a foreclosed property from a multi-bank, the FDIC states this is as is. There's no implied rights. There's no, you just take what you get. So I don't see how you could say that anyone's seizing property to enforce code in a county that they should have been aware of in 2010 to go back and do their research in the county codes. And when you're a builder, that's what you do. You do an impact analysis. You do a financial recoup analysis. That's what I understand happens in business. And last but not least, I do have to go back to the environmental benefits. I think that is a very large portion of the case. I have quoted some law, some cases, the Knight Moratorium of 1984, and the case of, this is environmental law, which again, I can only pass on my research and not as a legal expert. But these two cases speak specifically to the benefits of stream buffers and the additional stream buffers and affecting the quality of our water and the state tributaries that are spring fed and do feed into a main water supply. I don't think we can blow this off. I don't think it's something to say, oh, just live with it 5 years. That's just against everything I believe, but I think it's against everything you believe too. And I hope that you will take all of these matters into consideration and look at the facts and look at the analysis I've done in my method. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I want to talk to you a little bit about what this case is and what it is not. I know that the attorney for Rocklyn just said that vested rights are not transferable. I may respectfully disagree with that, but that it's not germane to this proceeding. I don't have to resolve that issue, nor do you, in my respectful estimation, for us to get to a conclusion this evening. This is about ZA 2936, right? This is about a 2004 zoning to Res 3 that was approved by your predecessor board, not you, but by your predecessor board. It resulted in, this is the consent order. It's three slides, but this is the consent order that was signed on September 4th, 2012. That is what, in fact, is the action of the BZA that you are here to talk about tonight. That's it. All right? I don't believe you will find in there anywhere where it suggests this is based on vesting that arose out of 2004 or 2005. It is a determination, though, and it is an action of the ZBA, which is why it is appealable. And I have no problem whatsoever with you, in fact, allowing us to go to merits. Quite frankly, it's helpful for me to get up here and explain, from at least my perspective, why this case was so challenging. Here's the resolution. That's the actual resolution from 2004 where the property was zoned to Res 3. This is some of the conditions. There's a conditional rezoning, right? Conditional rezoning is legal and lawful in the state of Georgia. I want to focus on this. I hope a little arrow just popped up on your screen. If it did, that's good. I'm doing great. Here's it blown up. That resolution adopted in 2004 said this. It is resolved that the Unified Development Code of South County, your zoning law and zoning map is amended by way of an action. We forget that sometimes in here, that when we modify, when we adopt a zoning that applies to a piece of property, do you understand that contemporaneous with that, you are actually modifying the zoning map of Forsyth County? And when we modify that zoning map, per this express declaration in the resolution, you also said this. It says the site plan submitted and dated August 14th, 2004 shall be the site plan of record for this rezoning. Now, let me tell you some facts. The reality is that every time there is a zoning, there is a site plan that is submitted as part of that zoning, right? That happens every time as a matter of rule. Our UDC requires it. But not every zoning has a stipulation that says that when this zoning is approved, that zoning site plan is the zoning site plan and the site plan of record. That's different. Let's go back. What is that? What is the consequence? I'll tell you what the consequence is. The consequence is that zoning condition meant that that zoning site plan became part of your zoning map. That's the consequence, and that's what I was having to grapple with. Forget about vested rights. You zoned the property and said this site plan controls the zoning. I don't need vested rights to get there. I just gotta go look at the zoning map. Keep going. Oh, you also added, again, when I say you all, by the way, that doesn't mean you. That means this, your predecessor board. The predecessor board also added this language. Any changes to that resolution that affect conditions have to come back before the Board of Commissioners. Any change affecting conditions. This is a matter of record. That's not happening. This is a matter of record. There's been no return to the Board of Commissioners with respect to any of the conditions that are controlling the situation this evening. That's not permanent. And of course, now, quite frankly, that's a little redundant, because the reality is if you want to change zoning conditions, we have to follow the Zoning Procedures Act. It would have had to come back before you anyway. But this simply reinforced the point. All right, so we know that we had a site plan specific zoning. Now, UDC says that a site plan must include buffers and natural areas. Buffers, what are we here talking about this evening? We're talking about buffers. So the site plan by rule had to include the very element that is dispositive of this situation tonight. And it did. There's the site plan. That is the site plan that was attached. In fact, if you look at the bottom right-hand corner, you will see something scribbled on there, not by me. I believe that's in the actual zoning file. And it says, this is the site plan referenced in zoning condition 2936. Now, unfortunately, it looks a little convoluted of it. You can't tell exactly what it says. So I've got my arrow popping up again, and now I'm going to highlight. You can't still see what it says, but if you will take my word for it, and Mr. Brown can flip through his file if he needs to, but all around there in the black text in the gray, it says 35 foot. So when Rocklin, and again, I'm not here to advocate for Rocklin, and I'm not here to advocate for the petitioner. I'm here to tell you why I did what I did, and that's all. So when I'm faced with that fact pattern right there, and I've got a site-specific zoning with a resolution change in the zoning map that specifically references that document right there, I've got some hard thinking to do. Okay? And that's in fact what I had to consider. Let's keep going. I've got some UDC provisions. I mean, one of the things you're gonna hear from me tonight, you're gonna hear the everything. Good, bad, ugly, all of it. Here's the UDC provisions. This is in our code right now. Unless otherwise specified by the board, site plans submitted as part of the application shall be considered binding on the applicant and must be followed, period. However, there's more. Site plans submitted under the requirements of this chapter are not engineered, and as such, the term binding does not imply that it is site plan specific. That's interesting. Rather, it implies that locations or uses are what the applicant intends to implement on the subject property. In any case, where the site plan conflicts with the code or a county regulation, and there's no approved variance, the regulation takes precedence. So it's a UDC provision. What does that mean? Here's my problem with it, is it applies to this section. First of all, every zoning has a site plan. So every zoning has a site plan that's sort of accompanying it down the zoning path. And so when you adopt the zoning, this is saying, yeah, and they're going to be generally held in the uses that were part of the site plan that accompanied it. But you have this language here that is just the bane of all lawyers' existence. Unless otherwise specified in the board approval. Well, in the board approval for this zoning, it did specify something different. You made it part of the zoning. It didn't just travel along in tandem with the zoning. The former board made it part of the zoning. You see the distinction? That was important to me. The board did do something different in that situation. And that made it different to me and not controlling the situation. But there's more. Ms. Albert alluded to it. Section 18.11.1, multi-phase land disturbance activities. This section deals with riparian buffers. I want you to look at C. If you've got an approved zoning that includes conditioning the property to a specific site plan that precedes November 14th of 2004, I'll just go ahead and tell you, you've got that. Here's what it says. It says, for such developments, discrete phases that have not been submitted for permanent approval as of the effective date of this article shall be allowed basically a 2-year grace period to get your permits in, and after that, you lose whatever protections you had with respect to your buffers. Now, that was very important to me. And I thought about that a long time. Here is my concern with that. I've got a zoning condition that can only be modified by compliance with the zoning procedures law. This section of the UDC attempts to place basically a sunset provision on that that says after 2 years, that zoning condition is rendered a nullity. I had to think about that. That concerns me a great deal. However, I will tell you, this gave me a lot of pause and made me consider going the way of upholding what staff had done. You want to hear the truth? This is the truth. Mr. Chairman, may I have a few more minutes?
Without exception.
Without exception.
I'm just getting started.
It's paid by now.
I want you to see one more provision of the UDC, though, because right now I've shown you one that I think is neutral, one that I think clearly supports the 50-foot buffers. Right? That's what I believe. And then I've got this. UDC 22-6.1, in the event a landowner filed and had approved an application for amendment to the official zoning map, got that, the property-specific zoning approval, including any site plan submitted and conditions of zoning, shall govern the use and development of the property irrespective or regardless of whether the development approved through the rezoning process meets the terms of this code. I hope everybody is inhaling right now and understands the significance of that. So I've got three UDC provisions that I've got to deal with. One, of course, with specifically caveats that the Board of Commissioners may do something different unless otherwise directed by the Board, which the Board directed something otherwise. I've got the multi-phase UDC condition, which I think speaks to this issue fairly clearly and goes in favor of 50-foot. But then I've got this section in the back of the UDC that says if you approve a zoning and there's a site plan attached to those conditions, they control irrespective of what else you do in the code, even if it conflicts. I don't like that language. I don't like it, and I'm not prepared to give it a wide berth as some folks want me to give it. But I will tell you this, I'm stuck with it for purposes of dealing with the constitutional demand that if we do the wrong thing, they're going to seek damages against my county. And then I've got this language in the law. Since statutes or ordinances which restrict an owner's right to freely use his property for any lawful purpose are a derogation of the common law, they must be strictly construed against the government. That's one of the highest standards of judicial construction that exists. Strict construction against us. And then I've got this language. Any ambiguities in the language employed in the zoning statute should be resolved in favor of the free use of property. So now, here is my thought process with Rocklyn sending me a demand letter and saying, we believe your planning staff got it wrong. I'm looking at three sections of the code that deal with the issue differently. I've got a zoning-specific site plan showing 35-foot buffers, and a code that could at best be argued to be ambiguous or unclear on this issue. And I've got that case law in Georgia. So if I'm in front of a judge, and I have said 50-foot, 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 that's it, and I'm faced with this, what is a court going to do? My respectful position, the reason I concluded the way I concluded, is I believe the closer, the better call is a court would say, your UDC is unclear, Mr. Gerard. In light of this case law, where I have to strictly construe that case law again, or the UDC against you, I have to rule no way. That was my call. Recommended that to Mr. Brown. I stand by it. So I've got more. I don't want to abuse the time that you've given me. But the reality is there are other approvals as late as last year recognizing a 35-foot buffer on that property, and that went into my analysis as well. So again, I'm not here to speak on behalf of Rocklyn, and I'm not here to speak on behalf of the petitioner. I'm here to tell you what I did and what I did. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, it's time for rebuttal to Ms. Amos.
Commissioners, again, I respect that this is a very sticky legal position that you're in. So I'm sorry. I want to go back. You do have the ability to make a decision. It says in the UDC code, you, the Board of Commissioners, has the ability to change what is on the books. I don't believe you should make a decision based on fear of being sued. That's not the way that I believe Americans should make decisions. I believe you make decisions on the merits. You don't make decisions, oh, we're afraid we're going to get sued, so let's do it this way. I believe that's very, very important in upholding standards and upholding laws that we have. And again, we're very, very concerned as the Champions Run and surrounding communities as well. We're very concerned about past behaviors and with this code of abuse and activities that have taken place. We implore you to uphold the current 50-foot stream buffer variance. If you should decide to go back to the 35-foot backwards in time, we respectfully request that Rocklyn Homes put a bond to the county to cover damages made during the period of construction to be used at the end of the construction period to repair the pond and to repair Champions Run Lake and the dam. And that should be a study done by a licensed engineer who is very, very capable and able to make that type of analysis. I wonder why Rocklyn has not embraced this beautiful area as an opportunity to sell their homes instead of as a negative that we're seizing property. So many selling points today's market is that you have a park-like environment and the selling price point is so much greater for a home that has a park-like setting that is beautiful that you can enjoy, as opposed to the negativity of, well, let's try to cover this up. Let's turn it into a French drain. Let's encroach upon the boundaries. Let's go to court, to the Supreme Court, because our lives are being constituted over this stream buffer. I wonder why, as a business model, can't embrace the county's watershed programs. They've developed a Midway Park and Big Creek, and embrace what's happening environmentally and turn that into a positive, and they may lose 8 lots, but a positive is that they would gain financially such a greater price point with their homes they can sell. I don't know why this concept is lost. So I'll leave you today with my propositions, and I hope that you will enforce the 50-foot buffers. Also, I'll leave you with the other thoughts in your decision and hope that you will actually postpone a decision that you have time to reflect and to study. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My obligation to my clients to make the best call I can make if we're to go into a lawsuit, we're going to win it. And so that does drive my decision. And this is an avenue by which you can overrule me. And if the Board of Commissioners thinks, and again, I'm not presupposing, I mean this in all good faith, I'm not being Elizabeth, but if the Board of Commissioners thinks that the argument is better the other way, I will respect that. But so long as you put this in my hands to make these calls and advise my staff members as best you can make them, when I do get, and yes, to Rockland's point, that letter is no different than every letter demanding threatened litigation every day. So there was nothing untoward about that letter, and certainly did not frighten anybody. It's the way business is done in the context of land use. But you nonetheless take it seriously. And I made the decision I made in order to be, you know, to advise my client of what I thought the legal merits were.
Well, you're saying our UDC is more ambiguous than it should be concerning this matter.
I'm saying on this issue, it absolutely is. I'm saying that that section, UDC chapter 22, needs to be looked at. I will tell you that you have got a plan in the community development department that is doing their absolute best to bring to you cleanups as quickly as they can, and that's going to be the one that's going to come.
But how can we apply that and you can hear the to this case here? I mean, we can't change UDC right now.
That's correct, you can't. That's the fact pattern I was stuck with as well. And if you were to ask me, you know, Mr. Gerard, what's the single greatest thing that led you to conclude the way you concluded? It's the case law. It's the same case law that Ms. Everett and Mr. Bloom know, it's the same case law the court would look at that says that a zoning statute, a zoning ordinance, is strictly construed against the government and any ambiguity goes to the right of free use of land, period. That's what I was stuck with. It gave me no great pleasure to enter into that consumer. But those are the kinds of strikes and balls you ask me to make every day.
One point is that 35 foot zoning plan is built into a site-specific plan. And it's always been there.
It's been there since 2004.
Yes, sir.
Any further questions?
I have a few questions for this lady here. Is that okay at this time, Council?
Of course.
I just want to make sure I have my facts in order. When did Rockland acquire the property? Roughly.
Sometime in 2010, I don't have the exact
okay.
date.
So there are already houses built in there, some of them?
Rockland has houses built.
In 2010, when you acquired the property, were there already houses built in there?
In the entire subdivision?
Yeah.
Windmark already built houses.
Yes, Windmark
already
built houses before okay. the real estate market.
All right, so this area, 35 foot in question on your map there, are there any structures already built in there?
In phase two, unit two?
Anywhere in there where there's a 35 foot buffer.
In this buffer we're talking about, along there.
Just want to make sure I understand your question.
Yes.
Are there any houses in this area right here, which is phase two, unit two?
Which is the point of discrepancy, right?
Yes, sir. No, we've applied for a land disturbance permit okay. so we can start developing that
right.
area.
In the other parts of the subdivision, there are houses in the 35-foot buffer?
Yes, sir.
Did you build any of them?
Yes, sir.
That's not her slide, that's my slide, but just to give the gallery, that's the multi-phase, and that's broken it down by phase, so at least the folks can see what you all are saying.
Why did we stop issuing building permits for this phase?
We had applied for a land disturbance permit for phase two, unit two, which is the first step in this, because it's such a large development, it's being developed in phases.
And get a new LDP.
Correct. Phase two. And that's when this controversy started, is when we submitted our LDP. So it wasn't a building permit. There were building permits issued on other parts of the larger subdivision. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. That's when all the 50 foot compared to the 35 foot came to line. by the WB.
Correct.
Did I finish out? Is that made your decision to not issue LDP?
It wasn't that we wouldn't issue LDP. It was our staff looked at it and requested our typical checklist comment was a 50-foot buffer requirement. That generated a lot of what we're talking today, a lot of back and forth between my staff and the applicant about should it be 50, should it be 35. And staff, we didn't hear anything to change our mind at that time. It went over to Ken's office at that point, our legal office, for additional review and more detailed review. Prior to that review being concluded, they've submitted the application to go to the Board of Appeals.
So it's basically your board, your planning department made the decision to have a 50-foot buffer as a standard buffer?
Correct.
I believe that they didn't actually, I don't think you ever actually made a determination on the LDP, but there was a decision on that note, and so we asked the county to make an official determination on that specific note within our LDP application, which gave us grounds then to appeal.
I agree with that. They specifically asked for a decision on that issue so they could move forward with the appeal.
I have a question for Ken. I hope you feel honestly rude. What I've gathered it on to this point is that very possibly, based on your legal conclusion on this and what you recommended, it may not, we probably should have sent them to go through a zoning appeal to begin with, the ZBA. If you believe that the state law trumps in this whole thing and this was a part of the sketch plan approval site specific,
well, that's a great question, and I will address it this way. The attorney for Rocklyn, which was not Ms. Everett, was Simon Bloom. It was under my office was looking at it from an administrative determination standpoint. As you all know, I make those in conjunction with Mr. Brown from time to time. But Mr. Bloom said, look, I'm afraid you will, I don't know what you're going to rule. I'm going to go ahead and get started in the process because I don't want to be held up if you rule against me, because then I just got to appeal your decision. So why don't I just go ahead and start the process while you're thinking about it and you let me know. So that was their decision. It was a strategic decision made by them to ensure they didn't get a decision from me they didn't like and then appealed back.
Do you think they were held up so long from the red tape of our office that they felt they were forced to do that? When in fact, if we ruled on this based on state law to begin with, we wouldn't have forced them to that avenue.
I don't think so. I mean, I think that the issue was complex enough where there was the need to have some time taken on this. And I will tell you this, for as strong as advocates against us as they can be, they also are sophisticated enough to know this is not a decision to make overnight. This took some time to make, and they appreciated that. So I don't believe Rockland would say there was some sort of a bureaucratic black hole they got shoved into. They understand how this works, and I got to tell you, it took me some time on the way through this.
Any further questions? There not, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
Salute.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there a motion from the board?
Mr. Tam, it's your district. You should have the opportunity.
What do you want me to do?
Board, I agree with you. I'm inclined to take this information, if we're allowed to, Counselor, and review it until the December 20th regular meeting.
The UDC provides that after the hearing, the decision of the board shall be announced in a public meeting, either following the hearing or at any other scheduled meeting. Suggests to me that a postponement is allowed.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-1. I was too. passes 4-1 for a delay in the decision on this, if I understood it correctly, Councilor. Any other magic words I need to say? Please go ahead.
No, there are no more magic words, and that was perfectly appropriate for the first one.
All right, so we're going to go through this again with Keystone, is that correct?
That's correct.
Are you going to leave, Ms. Albert? Are you getting ready to leave?
May I ask?
No, the answer was no.
May I just ask you to leave your contact information, Ms. Albert?
Yes.
With this gentleman right here? And yours as well, if you're going to leave him, please.
Before we get started, there is quite a large group here waiting on one item. That doesn't take very long at all. Is it possible we could hear that first?
Doesn't matter to me, but it doesn't seem like this. If we're going to just do this again, it doesn't seem like we're going to have a very long hearing again, are we? We're talking about the same subject matter, aren't we?
It won't be long for me, Commissioner Tam. And again, really, it's going to depend upon, I want to make sure that the petitioner, though, has a full and fair opportunity, because his presentation, candidly, could be different. So to the extent the board wanted to take, for instance, the Castle Variana before, I would request a motion and second to do that. But if that's certainly something you could do.
You mind, honestly, because it adds a couple of minutes up to deal with.
All right. Public hearing 4.
Yes.
AB 120002 Keystone HOA, located in Commission District Number 2. The public hearing is by Keystone HOA regarding the acceptance of a consent order for Rocklyn Homes Inc. AP 120001 by the Appeals Board on September 4th, 2012. The property is located on the west side of James Rivers Road, approximately 1,730 feet south of the intersection of Keystone Drive, and is currently zoned Res 3.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the same procedure will be in place with respect to this appeal as there was in the previous appeal. Pursuant to stipulation, we have agreed that any HOA board member with respect to Keystone will have the ability to come and present evidence. I believe we have a board member here. So, Mr. Chairman, without any further ado, the board would open up the administrative hearing, and the petitioner will get 10 minutes on the clock.
Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Fred St. Laurent. I'm the Vice President of the Homeowners Association at Keystone Development. Have been for 4 years. I'm a homeowner on the lake. Have two children. I have three children and a grandson. My two boys are at Lambert. It's great to see that tonight. And Commissioner Tam, you're my commissioner. I voted for you. I like your restaurant too. I love that place. When I look at this board,
politics.
What's that?
My food could be better than my politics.
Well, I'm not here to discuss politics. But when I do look around at everyone here, I see neighbors, I see taxpayers, I see business owners. Okay, I don't see a board. I don't see lawyers. Although I feel surrounded by lawyers at times tonight. I'm not a lawyer. I don't play one on TV. I put that in my letter to you. I'm a homeowner, you know, and a businessman myself. You know, I've heard a lot of things. I'm hearing a lot of things from my neighbors, from friends. They're all telling me what I got to say. And I'm overwhelmed with all of this information. I was under the impression that there were vested rights involved in this, and there's not. Rocklyn didn't exist in 2004. Windmark did. I do know that a couple of years ago, we had a flood in the back in Keystone. There was a lot of silt that clogged our drain. We couldn't even find the drain. We didn't know where it was. Well, it was on their property. And we called them. The county called. We called the county. Nobody could get them to come out to repair the drain. So we got together as a community, not just the lake owners, but the people up on the hill, and we found the drain. We had to trespass on their property to find the drain and do the repairs out of our own pocket. We had pumps, pump the lake down. It was actually doing damage to the berm. It destroyed my neighbor's fence. It destroyed some of my fruit trees in the back. I had real damage from this flood. And quite honestly, the developer, they were nowhere to be found. They didn't help. They were not responsible neighbors. I don't expect them to be. Our lake needs to be dredged. I'm not an expert, but I can tell you that needs to be dredged. They It's on their property, though. I own part of that lake. If anything happens, I'm, you know, financially responsible for coming up with the solution for my part of the lake. If they do any more damage with silt, and I'm looking at this plat, and they're building all around us with phase three and phase two. All right? They have a track record of muddying up the lake, and the attorney here says that, you know, what, 3 or 4 years it's going to be muddy? I stocked this pond. That pond is full of bluegill. My kids fish. I fish. We got bluegill. I had so much bluegill that I went to LJ and bought largemouth bass and stocked the ponds so that they would grow up and eat the bluegill. There's a 25-pound gar in there that swims around all the time. There's all kinds of turtles. We have ducks and geese that come in seasonally. There's deer. On my Facebook, I've got a deer that came right up to my door and was stopping trying to scare my cat. There's a habitat in there. There are eagles that come in. There are woodpeppers that are rare. It's a habitat that I enjoy, my family enjoys. If you muddy up that lake for 3 or 4 years, you're going to kill everything that I've invested in as far as the lake and enjoyment goes. You might as well take the berm out, which they threatened to do a couple years ago. I'm trying to raise my family in a community that I've come to love over the last 10 years. And what I'm seeing are developers that come in related to other developers that seem to be capable of anything, allegedly, to get their agenda across. I understand the difficult decision that was made. That's difficult case law. I went to Stetson, by the way, for a little bit. I won the bicentennial youth debates there. But I'm not aware. I just know that these things get very complicated. You all work for us, not the developer. There was a comment made in a video that I watched. My brother died in September on President Obama's motorcade in Florida. We went to the funeral. I came back and I'm hearing about these videos and what's happening here, and I sat down and watched the videos. There was a comment made that, well, one of us was adversarial to the county. A homeowner, a taxpayer, adversarial to the county. That was the comment that I heard. Kind of shocking. We're supposed to be working together here, and, you know, we're not adversarial if you work for us. So the issue is, I will suffer incredible loss. If I have to come up, you know, this is a tough economy. Business is tough. I'm mortgaged over here, and my house is not worth what it's mortgaged for, thanks to the economy. And so if something were to happen, if my neighbor, my developer neighbor, the builder, comes in there and makes a mistake that ends up making me liable, it's going to put me under. I'm going to lose my home. Never mind the lake. I'm just not going to be able to come up with the money to be able to fix whatever it is my part of it would be. If there's no bond or whatever, 35 foot. For some reason, the state of Georgia, and I'm not a lawyer, said 50 foot was what it was supposed to be. 50 feet. Now it's 35 because we want some building to go on, because something was drawn a long time ago. And quite honestly, Rocklin tried to do the due diligence before they shelled out all the money to do this. But we didn't get consulted on these changes. You didn't call me. I could have helped with the decision. When I looked at what they're going to put in over there, you know, the chances are that I'm going to lose the lake, and if I'm financially responsible for any of it. Now, my neighbor put in an irrigation system, and we share it. It draws water from the lake. We could pretty much kiss that goodbye the first time it silts up, like it had before in the past, when it clogged the rain and the flooding that we had. I'm imploring you to consider the fact that this developer wants to put in a few homes, and the profit on these homes is not that great. They're going to make some money. But the potential is that we could lose everything, my family. based on what they do and the responsibility that we have. If I have to trespass on their property to fix the problem they created, and they won't even call me back, what are they going to do in the future? I mean, they hired the same people over, you know, from Windmark, you know, and now it's Rocklyn, but it's not connected, right? This sounds like a sleight of hand to me. You know, don't look over here, but, you know, we're a different company now. We escaped that financial responsibility. Rocklyn wants all of the rights, but none of the responsibility. They want the right to do whatever it is they need to do. And hey, we need a better economy. Now, where's Plan B? The application that they filled out says that they need a Plan B in case Plan A doesn't work. I'd like to see it. There's supposed to be a Plan B that says, this is what we'll build if we don't get a 35. That's on the application. They got to check that box before they give it to you guys. Where is it? Did they show you a Plan B? Nobody's showing it here. It's Plan A or nothing. I get the feeling that some of you see that doing the right thing is 50 feet. And you're just looking for a reason to do it. I'm one of 8 homeowners right now, and I can speak for some of them. Some of them are gone, we didn't get a signature. That feel that there's too much risk involved in allowing this developer to do whatever it is they want to do back there. Thank you for your time.
Mr. Chairman, very briefly, Tim Severick, the president of the HOA, who is a qualified individual to speak, has asked to be heard. I believe there'll be a minute and 17 seconds left of the original 10.
Please come up and tell us your name.
Actually, Mr. Tam was on the board when we went through this years ago, so there was someone on the board. And I think if he remembers, we went through a lot with the conditions. I find it interesting that now there's not a vesting issue, because this was brought up. It was brought up with Rockland's attorney at the last meeting. So if you want to look at that video, you know, have at it, because vested rights was brought up. So now all of a sudden we're not in vested rights, okay. Also, we've been here twice before, and I say we, Champions Run, the people that are here now, thank goodness, they didn't exist because they weren't property owners. Prior to that, Keystone and other properties on Settles, whatever that road is that comes into James Burgess, fought for the rights for that land, fought for the 50-foot property. We had many meetings, which Commissioner Tam will know about. That's why he put the conditions on there, because we all got together collectively, and we tried to decide what was the best thing to do. And I want growth as much as you do, but there needs to be a correct way to do it. And I find it interesting that, and I respect Mr. Gerard, absolutely. I understand his position. However, we've got three different things here now that is in question. Three wrongs don't make right.
Ma'am, just a minute. That exception, when we render a motion.
That exception.
Three wrongs don't make a right. The county has not convinced me that they are clear on their decision. Absolutely not. And so I would ask, you know, the board to, you know, absolutely take a look at that. And like I said, we've been here twice before in front of the, I don't believe it was the commissioners, I believe it was the, a different, because you guys have different things, but they asked for a 50-foot buffer and was turned down twice. Okay, not Rocklyn, but Windmark, which, you guys turned them down. You turned them down one time, and they had already put the French drain in. And then they asked for forgiveness. And I think he mentioned Keystone Lake. If you want to know why Keystone's going to be affected, because when they did the French drain, it clogged up our lake, which he was speaking of. And we all had to get in the water and take care of our lake. And I have a letter that because I helped Fred do it, that will show you from the county stating that they could not make Rocklyn help us or do anything. It's in our submission that we submitted to you today. And a gentleman in Rocklyn came out and walked the property with us and said, there's nothing that I can do. So anything that is done, we're upstream, they're downstream. Anything that is done can affect Keystone Lake. Therefore, we'll put a hardship on the people on the lake, and I think you will see where we put the values on the houses on the lake, which is 7 homes. They are responsible. I'm the president, I'm not responsible, because it could cost them a lot of money. And if you want to go out and look at Keystone Lake, it's very old, and it is not up to par. So thank you so much.
Respectfully, this portion of the hearing is specifically with whether Keystone Homeowners Association has standing to bring their appeal. And I understand the emotions are high tonight, and I respect that, but it's my job to bring us back to the law and what the standard is. The application that you have, the appeal, is filed by Keystone HOA, and Ms. Coleman did sign it as their president. So it is the HOA that has brought this appeal. And Georgia law states that an HOA, a civic association, does not have standing to challenge a zoning ordinance unless it can show that it owns property that will be affected by the zoning decision. So remember, we talked about this before. The first step is you have to show a valuable property interest that's being affected. And unfortunately, there is no evidence before you tonight that the Keystone HOA owns property. You just heard Ms. Coleman say that there are 7 individual homeowners within the Keystone subdivision that have title to part of that lake, the Keystone Lake, but not the HOA itself. And I can cite the board to the Georgia Court of Appeals case of Preservation Alliance of Savannah, Inc. versus Norfolk Southern Corporation. It's reported at 202 Georgia Appeals 116, and it's a 1991 case, and it's on this very issue, where a civic association brought a zoning appeal. But the civic association couldn't show that it owned any specific property that was going to be affected, and it was not joined by an individual homeowner. And that is the case here. We don't have an individual homeowner bringing this appeal. It is brought only in the name of the HOA. I'd like to point out to you that it's hard to see from this map, and I appreciate that, but because of the elevations, all of this water here actually flows this way into this larger lake. And the Keystone Lake that they're talking about is over here. And so this 35-foot buffer area that we're talking about tonight all flows this way, away from their property. So there's no evidence before you that anything we do with respect to this 35-foot buffer would impact their, not their lake, but the lake, the Keystone Lake, that's owned partially by some residential, or residents, 7 individual owners. I don't think that it's germane at all to your decision tonight, but I feel like I should, if you're, the board will allow me, address the issues, the repairs to the lake they mentioned several years ago before Rocklyn owned this property or even existed. There was an issue with the lake. The county contacted the county, and respectfully, we were told you can't do anything. You don't have a permit. And so we were unable to do any work on the lake at that time. As you know, you guys regulate us very strictly. We have to follow the rules, and we respect that, and we want to follow the rules. And so we weren't able to do any work. And I understand it might have been there was maybe a basketball clogging the drain. So there's no evidence before you that anything that we're going to do in Phase 2, Unit 2 will affect any property owned by the Keystone HOA. And so therefore, we respectfully request that you do not have, that this HOA does not have standing to bring this appeal before you. And just so the record's clear, earlier when I was talking about water being muddy for 3 to 5 years, that was what the expert in that case that I was citing found with respect to that development. I'm not making any representations about that. We want to keep this project clean. We're going to use BMPs. We're going to do everything we can so that that's not happening here. I just want to make sure that there was no misunderstanding of what I was saying. That was simply the court's holding in a reported case that I was discussing earlier. Those are my comments. And so if you have questions, obviously I'll be.
Chairman, it's time for us. Oh, can we allow the rebuttal? We did the rebuttal with the questions. Is that okay? And just for purposes of the record and the procedures, it does allow the county to speak now, not waiving with respect to the standing issue. So at this point, it would be appropriate for Keystone to come up for their rebuttal.
One thing I would like to say is I think she's incorrect. An HOA is actually voted on, and the people in the community, which is 32 homes, put me as a president to look after their community. I have signed documents stating that I can speak for them, and actually the vice president here is on the lake, so what she said when no one was on the lake is incorrect. And the statement that it won't affect Keystone is incorrect because we already have that. We already had it happen. And I think one thing is very interesting that Rocklyn has nothing to do with Windmark. This gentleman sitting right back here with this lawyer came with Windmark to tell us he couldn't do anything with the lake. So that's interesting to me.
I'd like to ask you a question. And first of all, just to clarify, corporation charters. Oh, I'm sorry. Was that, you got more rebuttal?
I have more rebuttal.
Yeah, you got more rebuttal. Okay. Go ahead. I'll ask my question later.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Sorry. Thank you very much.
Yeah. No.
So the homeowner association brought the appeal. I would appeal this if I wasn't attending my brother's funeral and I knew more about it. This has been rushed. You know, I get loud. I'm not angry. I was a stage actor. I worked in amphitheaters, and so I project. Okay? I am emotional about this because it does affect me at home. So if what this decision is going to be based on is whether or not the homeowners association brought this appeal, or if a group of homeowners, including myself, and I would have appealed this if it hadn't been rushed. I saw the attorney Bloom pushing it through last time, even though it wasn't really a public hearing or administrative hearing at that meeting. He pretty much pushed his agenda through and was asking you to vote on it because of the great loss every day they didn't build. They're going to lose money. Now, he's a very aggressive attorney. His firm's known for getting results, you know, by being aggressive. And I respect what you're saying here, is that the Homeowners Association filed the complaint. But I'm on the Homeowners Association, and I'm on the lake. And maybe if they sue you, that might be a hold. If we could table this and let me file an appeal as a homeowner, and let me get the other homeowners to do it as well. Let's do this. If the Homeowners Association can't appeal, I want to appeal. Give me a chance.
I think all those times have expired.
What's up?
I think all those times have expired. And I can appreciate what you say, but it kind of goes to the same thing that I was going to say about the Windmark Rockland issue. It's separate corporate entities. It doesn't matter if it's the same officers. We have to, everybody, the state and the federal government, it's separate entities. So living, breathing entity as far as the state's concerned. And as far as I think you have filed an appeal, I'm terribly sorry about your brother, but the time has expired to do so.
So if Rockland's going to push this through the way they did, and I have no chance to appeal, the best I can do is appeal to you to do the right thing.
But we have a law that we have to follow to make these decisions.
I understand the law. I have family and law enforcement. I have great respect for the law.
Some things we just don't have the ability to.
The law was to protect people.
I understand, but something we don't, and it's also to protect their rights. Everybody has equal rights. And the law also just doesn't allow us to arbitrarily say, well, we're sorry you were out of town for whatever reason. So we're going to allow you to, you know, stand in. We can't.
So we have no standing because it's a homeowner's association.
I didn't mean to say.
Okay. I'm not wasting my breath.
When we talk about the flow of the water, though, does it move away from Keystone?
If you look at this, because that's not accurate, and I might need some more time to learn out. But I was studying this just before, during the break. And if you look where, well, I guess up away from that. Look where Keystone Lake is. It's right here.
Right.
Thank you. And which we're going to build it all here. Now, this is upstream.
No, sir. No, sir. They're building above it.
What about here?
We're not talking about that tonight.
You're never going to build it.
We're not talking about that tonight.
Okay, we're not talking about that.
We're talking about on the above that area right there. And if the water flows away from Keystone, we have nothing really to even talk about. Now, when the other lots come along, you can certainly appeal those at that time. But if the water's not flowing towards you, we really don't even have a reason to be discussing it tonight.
We're not talking about these right here?
No, not tonight.
We're talking about that.
That's it.
And now this sets precedent for here and for here.
I think the law sets the precedent for it. I think the law is the law, and the law is we follow it in all cases. But tonight, I don't see that you're impacted by it because it's flowing away from you. So if we give you another opportunity, you know, the bite of the apple, when they come back next time.
All right, well, thanks for the extra time. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, unless the Keystone wants some additional time, do you need any additional?
I'm not understanding this because a stream flows into our lake. You're saying it doesn't impact anything. This is a state water stream. Our lake goes into the streams that do this, that go down to Grand Cascades. There's no.
It's not coming towards you.
Of course it's not. It can't go uphill. It's got to go down.
So you can't be impacted.
Okay, let me explain this, okay? Mm-hmm. Do you remember me telling you the impact we have from the French Drain? It's over in the same area. Why do you think we have the problem with the French Drain? Excuse me, I do get emotional. Because I have been dealing with Windmark Rocklin since 2002. And I'm just really upset I'm even here, okay? So I'm sorry if I get a little upset. But when you're going downstream, and I'm not an engineer, but I'm not stupid, okay? When they do something with a stream, and when you're allowing them to build closer than 50 foot, or you know, and you're giving them 35 feet, okay, so they're damaging some of that property. If they do anything to this stream, that's what happened when it backed up our lake. You understand what I'm saying?
Can I ask, because I just want, the eight lots that we're referring to, do those eight lots that they're looking to get 35 foot buffer on, opposed to 50, do those eight lots go down to the strip, to the lake of the seven homeowners? Does that go downhill to there?
Okay,
we're here about the eight lots in question.
Okay, you got eight. Okay, you got a lake.
Those eight lots that they're looking to get their variance on.
Correct.
The 35 from the 50. Do those eight lots? Does that water? Those eight lots. Does it flow down into the lake that you're referring to, the seven homeowners zone, and that you're the homeowner association president for?
Okay, let me explain this. If a beaver puts a dam here, and you've got work over here, what happens?
We're not talking about that. We're talking about
it. But it doesn't matter. This is what happened to our lake before. This is what I'm trying to tell you. If they have a problem or cause a problem downstream, it is going to back up Keystone Lake, which will cost the homeowners a lot of money.
We're here on the eight specific lots. Do those eight specific lots are referring to
you would, look,
here?
You asked me.
You
asked me for fine. How it could affect Keystone, and I'm trying my best to tell you how. When you do anything to a stream, downstream, and if something was to happen to the flow of the land, it is going to back up the dam, the stream, from Keystone. It's not going to affect maybe their lake, but it's going to affect ours, and so that's why we appealed it.
I think what he's saying, with these eight lots, is it possible that they can generate enough?
Then how do we have the problem? Or she said a basketball.
But we're not here to talk about the problem.
What we're talking about is the possibility that could happen, because it's already happened, because of the damage that they did, okay?
They who?
The Windmark.
Was it Windmark or was it Rocklyn?
At that time, it was Windmark.
But we're not here to talk about Windmark.
Well, this, okay.
I mean, I understand
you guys make your own decision. That's fine, but you're not looking after your county when if you make the wrong decision. Okay.
And just, I do understand what you're saying now with the backup water.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not sure exactly. We sort of blanched from the rebuttal time into question and comment, but now is the time for board additional questions if you have any of any of the parties.
Sir, who you mentioned you own part of the lake that you're concerned about?
Yes, if you look at the surveys, our land extends out into part of the lake.
If you know how many other folks?
Seven homes.
What about homeowners associations or Rockland? Is the entire lake bounded by the seven homes?
One side of it is. The other side is Rockland. It used to be Windmark.
So the HOA doesn't own any of the lake?
HOA doesn't own any of the lake.
Did the HOA grant us appeal? Then there's nothing to hear tonight. I'm sorry. It's just not. The HOA doesn't own the lake, then there's nothing. I mean, they would have to appeal as individuals. I'm sorry.
HOA is bound. It, you know, you are elected.
And could you please come to the microphone?
What was the time limit?
The HOA is you, look, you guys live in the subdivision, right? Do you have an HOA?
No.
Okay. What do they do for you?
I don't have one.
Next dues.
If they had a problem, would they go to bat for you?
They collect dues.
That's all they do. Well, then you have a bad HOA. An HOA, in our HOA, it says that we are to protect and we are to help them with their rights.
Well, I think that's noble, but the HOA who filed this appeal.
Can you show me law that tells me that my HOA, that I can't look after my people
I can't, but what you don't understand is the HOA has filed an appeal, mm-hmm. but the HOA owns no property, so therefore it can have no standing. That's what the law says. And that's pretty clear. That is so, it's unfortunate in your case and in your case, but it is what it is. It doesn't have anything to do with whether you look after him or go to bat for him or talk on his behalf or whatever. But the law says that the appellant or the petitioner has to have standing. In order to have standing, you have to own the property.
So you can't file it on their behalf?
What was the deadline?
I don't know what the deadline is. Tommy, do you know off the top of your head?
You said it expired. I thought maybe you knew.
Well, it's been a long time.
30 days. It is expired.
I understand your position. I understand her position. But you don't understand we're bound by law. It's not an arbitrary decision about what we'd like to do. It's what we have to do.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure you can.
Okay. I was never notified as a homeowner about any of this. Were we supposed to be notified?
I don't know. No.
Notified
of what? Of these changes in the buffer?
Well, they run a legal ad, I guess, they post a sign.
This decision, and Ken can speak to this, Rob Baranai, there was a decision between his office and mine to send this to the ZBA just to give the opportunity to take this out from a internal discussion to one where people were aware of it, and people became aware of it, and that's why we're here tonight.
Thank you.
It's unfortunate, Mr. Chairman, but I don't think we have any choice. Is the administrative
Agree with you. Okay. Yeah, the lake is upstream from this creek.
Yeah, it's upstream.
Commissioner Bell, if I could just, you just asked me in the last few minutes the appeal time frame. I said 30 days, and it is 10 days for the decision of the Zoning Board of Appeals. I want to clarify that.
Thank you.
Ken, do you have anything to say?
I don't, Mr. Chairman, except that if the board has finished answering or asking questions, you can go ahead and close the administrative hearing.
I have one for you.
Yes, sir.
Do you believe that there's a property owner that has filed an appeal in this case?
I would respectfully ask that I not make that answer, because I've been down in front of you arguing, and I don't want to overreach.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Does the law state that the applicant or the petitioner has to own property, or would you prefer we not even ask that tonight?
That's what I would prefer.
Thank you. Yeah, do you have something?
Like this case, and I only have one copy, but I'm happy to.
Why don't you just go ahead and read it, the pertinent part?
This is from the case I mentioned earlier, where it quotes and says, "Where a civic association," and later in the case it defines that as a homeowners association, "where a civic association seeks to contest a zoning decision, the Supreme Court has held that it must, quote, own property affected by the rezoning or be joined by individual plaintiffs who have standing to do so," end quote. And that's quoting the Supreme Court of the Lindsay Creek et al. Association versus Consolidated Government of Columbus case. And I have a copy I'm happy to provide to you. This is the case I was referring to.
What would be considered a joining?
I'm not a lawyer.
My interpretation would be named in the actual application itself. The applications. That's what governs, and your code even says you have to complete an application, it must be complete, and then it can't be amended, and it must be completed within the initial time frame. That's what gives us, for all of us to know who we're dealing with.
Okay. Any other questions?
Just so y'all understand, we have to take an oath. Part of that oath is that we follow the laws. We apologize if we voted on something that doesn't favor you outside that, but we have to follow the law, whether we like that or not.
It's not something that we enjoy doing either. I mean, if we don't follow the law, then of course we end up in court where we're not going to be successful anyway. And so it's just.
Patrick, can we close the district here?
Yeah.
Make a motion to close the district here.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. I think this is District 2 again.
Ms. Beerman? I move to grant standing.
Could you clear the board, the voting board, please? I'm not hearing a second.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion.
Well, wait, then I believe that bill would be like this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I make a motion. We do not stand.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please call on the motion. And that passes 4-1. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I have two housekeeping matters. In light of that, what we are left with is a situation where the second appeal would stand terminated. The first appeal will proceed and has been postponed. I also want the record to reflect Three things. The record needs to be perfected for if there is a potential challenge to these proceedings, the record needs to be complete, as it would be, that would be what would be sent to the Superior Court. I have three documents. I'm not aware of anything else, but I've got basically my PowerPoint that I put up that would be part of the record. Ms. Albert's lengthy book would be part of the record. I would prefer to have your site plan, which you have repeatedly referenced. I'd like to have that be a part of the record. And to the parties, I'll say, is there anything I'm missing that was discussed or a piece of paper that needs to be part of the record that you want to bring to my attention? I just don't want to miss anything and someone file an appeal and it not be in there.
Would it be appropriate for us to include our record that we submitted to the ZBA?
That would be a part of the record already.
Okay.
It's in front of the ZBA.
Then everything we have document-wise is in that package.
All right. Mr. Chairman, could you just, for the record, recognize the Ms. Albert's packet, my PowerPoint, and then, of course, we will need to get a copy of the plat, and that will be part of the record we made and given to the clerk part of the record.
And how shall we recognize?
Just, you just did it. That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, item number five is removed, which I believe takes us to old business. If I have missed something, one A has been postponed. Which takes us to item two.
Old business item two, Buckhead Pizza Company LLC, doing business as Buckhead Pizza Company, located in Township District Number 2. This is a decision from an administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Buckhead Pizza Company LLC, doing business as Buckhead Pizza Company at 415 Peace Street, Suite 200. The name of the employee is Catherine Gibson. In this particular administrative hearing that you heard at your prior meeting, the employee was issued two citations, one for underage sales, one for not having a sales ID. The citations were issued on February 9th, 2012, and they were the first citations issued to this employee.
Thank you, Tom. Is there a motion to open the administration?
I'm sorry, commissioners, let me clarify.
No.
We will not have an administrative hearing.
Just the decision.
This is a follow-up to an administrative hearing. Thank you.
Withdrawal.
Withdrawal.
I guess it's to District 2.
Yes, if it pleases the board, I would make a motion that Ms. Gibson surrender her alcohol permit on January 1, 2013 for a period of 30 days.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Which passes unanimously.
I have two, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Number one, the old business number two, if we could move that to the end of new business and right before the administrative hearings, the attorney for one of the parties is still stuck in traffic and is unable to be here to review about it. So if we can just move that, we might need a short break before that. So if we could put that as number 12, or actually just move it. It's old business, so just move it right before the administrative hearings. It's old business number two.
So that's
my motion.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, we'll vote. And that passes unanimously.
Yes, sir. My name is Philip Baker. I live at 1680 Thunder Gulch Pass, which is part of Champion Club Subdivision, which I think you all know that there is a question of the setback that Rocklyn Homes wants. And we all know that the changes that have been made in UDC from 35 to 50 foot. Now, problem we have is all of the erosion control problems that I would like for you to review. We can pull down records from the engineering department. I have worked with John Nard for many years through this development. And Jeff Chance, before he left, and I think Tom Dillon stepped in, actually had to have Ken Girard step in order to straighten out a mess after these people got foreclosed on and walked away from it. But that's past history. The bottom line is, if you would look at the records that you have access to and find out how many non-CEOs are currently standing on this phase, and if you go back and look at the other phases where they are claiming that based on the plan of record, which is part of the actual zoning conditions, which I was part of. I sold part of my property. I've been in this county since 1977, and I've been dealing with this issue ever since these developers have stepped in. I'm asking you to reevaluate this and take a very stern look at setbacks. If you don't do this now, you want to set a precedence. And we're going to have more issues. I'm agricultural. I abut residential zone, what is it, R3, R2, several of them, all around. Now, that creek flows through my property. I welcome each and every one of you to come out and see the pond that my livestock get water from and the settlement that has occurred since January of this year. Because before Rocklyn came back in and bought the property from the FDIC, which I had to spend thousands of dollars to get part of the zoning conditions attended to.
Excuse me, do you wish to grant some time this morning? Without exception?
2 minutes.
2 more minutes, sir?
That's fine.
Okay.
Just go downstairs to engineering. Go and look at erosion control. See any violations that have taken place. And we're not just talking about the next phase. Go back and look at the phase that Rocklyn actually stepped back in and the things that have occurred. Now there's two developers. There's Rocklyn and D.H. Horton. D.H. Horton abides by the rules and regulations of this county. And if there's an erosion control problem, they tend to it. Rocklyn puts it off and off and off. They'd rather pay the fines. Please, take the time, go down to engineering, pull the records. We have paid to pull those records. And Ms. Albert has presented them to you. But just go down and look at what currently is right now being held before you make a decision on allowing them to encroach 35 feet. That's all I ask. Thank you, gentlemen.
Our next speaker is Carol Albert.
My name is Carol Albert. I wanted to thank you so much for giving us a platform to hear our concerns concerning this appeal on the string variance.
buffer. And I presented quite a booklet for you to look at November the 15th. Hopefully you've had a chance to look through those documents. I've continued to email Ken Gerard. I'm very grateful for his time to send back pertinent information. And we're still left with a lot of unanswered questions about the zoning, the original zonings, the site plans. We ask that you really take a very serious look. I know you've been advised to vote for Rocklyn, but we're still appealing to vote against their appeal to uphold the current county standards of the 50-75 foot. And just for the record, I want to state that the zoning at the time of the 2936 was also attached to a zoning of 2967, which stated clearly at that time that all stream buffer variances, you can look on your records of 2967 zoning, it's public record, had a 50-75 foot stream buffer variance. I don't know why it was left off of 2936. I wasn't there. I did live in Forsyth County. I think this is significant. I know there's been so many other documents presented to go in other directions, but for the record, I believe that's significant. I believe we should uphold those standards. I believe Forsyth County should promote clean water. We don't have clean water in this waterway. It's a state stream. That's all we're asking for. I don't think that's outlandish to want clean water. And I hope that you will take these factors into consideration with your decision today, and we're very grateful for you hearing our concerns. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was our final speaker, Mr. Chairman.
Jody.
I'm waiting on Ethan, Commissioner.
I saw
that. Might deem desperate to put trees on.
Well, Ethan asked me.
If it's a specification,
that's the term.
Right, and that's my concern, is that that is strictly for that. I mean, you all have agents, and
Yes, you're just a little more in there.
should have packed it.
I'd like to call the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners meeting out of recess.
Let me do my best.
You're going to talk us through? What are you talking about?
Okay, we are out of recess. All commissioners here. So we are two commissioners. Old business number two, Commissioner Tam.
Counsel, I'm going to defer to you.
I've been here 9 years.
Chairman, members of the board, old business item number two is actually a continuation of the postponement of an appeal by Carol Albert with respect to ZBA decision AP120001 involving Rocklyn Homes. You may recall this is the hearing where we had a true bona fide hearing in front of you, and all the parties came and spoke. And you may recall that you affirmed standing to Ms. Albert. We had the hearing on the merits, and then we delayed or postponed the decision. You know, that matter is now before you this evening on the decision. I believe, Mr. Chairman, we have a tentative resolution of the appeal. I don't want to get ahead of myself. I know that particularly Ms. Albert is just hearing about this or sort of digesting this tonight, so I want to be as candid and clear as I can be in articulating the terms. I believe that Rocklyn Homes has presented some terms of settlement that involve protections of the stream buffer area and things of that nature that may be acceptable to Ms. Albert. I believe they have what I would consider to be a deal in principle. It does still need to be memorialized or written up, and of course signed off on by Ms. Albert and signed off on by Rocklyn Homes. So to the extent the board wants to make a decision tonight, what I have recommended to the chairman is to make a motion of a conditional denial of the appeal. A denial of the appeal ratifies the decision of the ZBA. A conditional denial of the appeal subject to review of a finalized settlement agreement between Ms. Albert and Rocklyn Homes brought to you at the first regular meeting in January.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second.
Mr. Chairman, just before you take a vote, I just want to make sure to, Ms. Can I get that right instead of this voice? And Ms. Albert, is that fair enough? Just a direct reflection, nod her head. So I think it's at least the best I can do when I'm trying to capture what they discussed. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you. Good luck. All right, now we are to administrative hearings. Director of planning.
If it helps at all, I know Ethan's on his way, but I hate to put him out. We've already come up with something that we don't have to change any of the verbiage with it. Mr. Kennard, if we can bring that item back up, we probably could be disposed of it pretty quickly. And call Ethan back and tell him I'll take it. I'm all the better.
Item two.
Old business item 2AB120001, Carol M. Albert, located in Commission District Number 2. This was a request for appeal by Carol M. Albert regarding the acceptance of the consent order of Rockman Homes Inc. Here at AP120001 by the Appeals Board on September 4th, 2012. The Board of Commissioners denied this appeal at their meeting on December 20th, 2012, conditioned upon Rockman Homes and Carol Albert presenting to the Board of Commissioners a signed document memorandum memorializing a settlement. This property is located on the west side of Kings Burgess Road, approximately 1,730 feet south of the intersection of Keystone Drive, and is currently zoned Res 3.
Thank you, Tom.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, consistent with the board's directive at that last meeting when the decision was made, On December 27th, Rocklyn Homes did in fact tender a proposed written settlement agreement to Ms. Albert. Today at approximately 4 p.m., Ms. Albert did respond and indicated that she had not had the opportunity to get with all the members of her association that she was working with to decide whether those, the terms of settlement as presented by Rocklyn were appropriate. Therefore, there is no written settlement agreement to present to the board this evening. My respectful request to you would be, I don't read anything in the correspondence that indicates that they still cannot come to terms. What I see is that there's simply because of the holidays, there was not enough time to get consensus between the two parties. My recommendation, respectfully to the board, would be that you postpone this item until the January 8th work session and allow me to communicate to both Rockland and Ms. Albert. The board will take this matter up at that time. If there is not a settlement agreement in place, then the board will have no choice but to otherwise go ahead and take binding action with respect to the appeal, irrespective of whether there is a compromise between parties. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor.
I agree with that motion.
Second. We have a motion and a second to postpone to January 8th. Please vote. Passes 4-0. Commissioner Levent, absent. On the new business.